Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the MedStar Health 2014 Heart Health Webcast. We've got some great information for you tonight. Thank you so much for joining us. We want you to get involved in the program. It's a live webcast. We are live in the Conference Center at MedStar Union Memorial Hospital. And again, thanks for joining us so much tonight. I am Kelly Sroop from WMAR ABC2. If you're watching us at home tonight via Ustream, it's accessible through Facebook or our website at medstarhealth.org. We want you to post comments so we can hear from you to be involved in the conversation tonight. But again, we have a panel full of five exceptional experts here to take all of your questions and your concerns. We want you to get involved. We want you to ask questions, and you can ask those questions at #AskMedStar. So again, let's get started here. I want to introduce some of our panel that is with us here tonight. Let's start right here on the end with Dr. John Wong. He is the chief of the cardiac catheterization unit here at MedStar Health at Union Memorial Hospital. We have Dr. Karuna Ketlo-Gatswe from MedStar Harbor Health Hospital, and she's a cardiologist, board certified, and also internal medicine. Dr. Michael Fiocco joining us here. He is of the Baltimore region, cardiac surgeon for MedStar Health. Dr. DJ Champ also joining us here. He's an expert in EP, and he's going to talk to us about electrical physical activity. And Dr. Jeffrey Courtner joining us here. He is the chief here at Union, not the chief at Union Memorial Hospital, but he's an expert in cardiovascular disease as well as he's one of our top experts. We're going to get started here. We've got so much going on, so let's get right to the questions from Dr. Courtner. You hear so much. This is February. It is Heart Month. You hear so much about knowing your risk factors, knowing your numbers. Tell us, what does it mean when you say someone has heart disease?
The heart is an extraordinary organ. It functions as a pump, and in doing so, it works, as you would imagine, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It never stops. So regardless of what we're doing, what our activities are, the heart has to work to provide blood and oxygen to the rest of the body so that we can carry on the tasks that we do during a day. Now, as a pump, it's made up of a number of different parts. It's got muscles, it's got valves, and it's got arteries. So heart disease particularly can affect any of those aspects. What we're really going to talk about, I think, first tonight is coronary artery disease. So as a muscle, just like your biceps, your legs, when in fact it's doing its work, it needs blood and oxygen to make it work appropriately. In order for the heart muscle to get its blood and oxygen, it goes through a set of arteries that are called the coronary arteries. Now, over time, these arteries can develop blockages, plaque buildup. You will hear about this later on how to prevent this, but what plaque and buildup of blockages will do is create a problem where this heart muscle will not get enough oxygen, not get enough of the nutrients to supply it to make it work appropriately. That can lead us to a number of different problems, angina or chest pain, or ultimately to a heart attack, which can obviously be life-threatening and which we're trying to prevent.
And it's the possibility that you could end up in a cardiac cath lab where you might see Dr. Wong. Tell us what would happen if you ended up in the cardiac cath lab, doctor.
So in the cardiac cath lab, we perform heart catheterization procedures where we're threading up small catheters into the heart to inject contrast into these blood vessels. We're looking for these blockages in the coronary arteries that are made of cholesterol as well as sometimes calcium. As Dr. Courtner states, when these blockages get severe enough, patients can get chest pain, and if it's 100% blocked, they can have a heart attack. In addition to taking pictures and finding these blockages, we're actually able to do procedures with balloons and stents to open these blockages. And one of the newest ways to do this is actually through vessels in the wrist versus the ones in the leg.
And that would be the transradial.
Correct.
Now, how does that ease the process? Does that make it better? How does that help in terms of going in through the wrist versus the groin, which is
absolutely
where they used to in the past?
So most patients that have a heart catheterization through the groin tell you that the worst part of the procedure was the fact they had to lay flat afterwards. Beyond the inconvenience of having to lay flat, the fact that approximately up to 1% of patients can have a bleeding complication. And 1% doesn't sound like a lot unless you're that 1%. Mm-hmm. And so people have developed years ago this approach through an artery, the radial artery, through the wrist. And the distinct advantages for patients are, number one, this is a much more comfortable procedure. As soon as the procedure is done, they're able to sit up, They can walk around. They can eat with their other hand and go to a regular bathroom, for example. The other thing is that the risk of bleeding complications from the catheterization from the wrist is virtually zero. So it makes it for a much safer procedure.
You know, when you think of February, February is Heart Month, and you often hear about your prevention and your risk and things that you can do to deal with heart disease. It is very common. It's the number one killer, and as a matter of fact, 1 in 3 die from heart disease. But let's talk about it when it comes to, in terms of women dealing with heart disease. Dr. Ketlogaswey is going to join us now to talk about women. You hear about women and heart disease, but it's different, though, when you're talking about the warning signs when you compare women to men. What are the differences, doctor?
So Kelly, like you said, heart disease is the leading cause of death for both men and women. And 1 in 3 women in America die from heart disease, and that's more from heart disease than from all the leading causes of cancer combined. What many people don't realize is that more women die from heart disease than men. Sometimes it's a function of just epidemiology, right? So women are living longer, and the older you get, the increased risk you are for heart disease. And as women outlive men, more women die from heart disease. But also women may delay getting treatment for heart disease because they don't recognize some of the symptoms and signs of heart disease and a heart attack. So the stereotypical elephant sitting on my chest that you often hear that metaphor for men, many women don't experience that. Instead, they have more vague or non-specific signs and they don't pay attention to them. They can have things like shortness of breath. They can complain of a squeezing, a pressure instead of a pain, jaw pain, nausea, abdominal pain, or just an insidious, profound fatigue out of proportion to what's going on. And if you don't recognize some of the signs, then you can delay seeking the life-saving treatments that we can offer to you, for example, in Dr. Wang's cath lab.
We have a question coming in from our chat room. The person says, guest 816 said they had a stress test and their heart rate did not go up. They administered Lexiscan. Over 3 months later, she still gets aches periodically. Should I be concerned that the lesion damaged my heart?
How old is the patient, you said?
We do not have an age.
So I think it's important to discuss your symptoms with your physician. And while a stress test can give you answers, if there's concerning enough symptoms, the risk factors are there, then it may prompt us to actually want to go and look in the coronary arteries if the situation is right.
Another person asked if you have a pain in her right arm and pressure behind her ear, should she be concerned? Now, the pain in the right arm, is that typically associated with men?
It's usually pain in the left arm as opposed to the right arm. But any symptoms that are concerning to you are ones that you should bring up with your doctor. And again, knowing your risk factors, assessing what your risks are part of the, you know, the way we deal and interpret and assess our patients. So bring your concerning symptoms up to your doctor. It's absolutely important to discuss them.
A lot of things that you should be concerned about in terms of when you're thinking about heart disease and different aspects of heart disease that you can be impacted by. We're going to talk now to Dr. Fiocco about aortic stenosis. Tell us about that. What is it? It affects over 1.5 million people. Does that mean it's really something serious that we should really be concerned about?
It is very serious, and it's essentially aortic stenosis is narrowing of the aortic valve. So every time the heart contracts and pumps blood out and delivers that oxygen that Dr. Kortner was referring to, it has to go through that aortic valve. So every time the heart beats, that valve has to open and close. And so what we're seeing as our population gets older and as we get better doing our diagnostic tests, we're seeing more and more people with aortic stenosis or narrowing of that valve. It is very important, and this is something that we all like to stress, that people who have a heart murmur are evaluated with an echocardiogram because aortic stenosis does not get better and it doesn't stay the same. It only gets worse. And the real problem we see is that it gets worse in such a slow, insidious pattern that many times the patient doesn't recognize it. And the patients, we see patients come in, they say, well, you have aortic stenosis, it's getting severe, it's probably should be operated on. And they say, well, I feel pretty good, I'm kind of afraid of that operation. And if you continue with that approach and wait until you feel really terrible, most of those patients are already suffering from a dilated heart or an enlarged heart, and they're subtracting years from their life expectancy. So aortic stenosis is a big part of our patient population now, and very important that we are aggressive and the patients are aggressive about How severe is it? Let's get it diagnosed. And more importantly, let's get it fixed early rather than waiting till you're sick.
So Dr. Fiocco, if I'm a 49-year-old male, 240 pounds, how will my heart valve replacement recovery differ, let's just say, from my 80-year-old father?
It's really hard to say. You know, those parameters say that anybody 49 is going to have a more rapid recovery and a much lower risk than somebody who's 80 years old. But what we like to, first of all, we're seeing more and more 80-year-old people come for aortic valve surgery. And what I like to tell them is that there's a reason you got to be 80 years old. You have a certain health and a certain strength to you. And it's remarkable how well these 80-year-old patients do. But if you look at it statistically, nationally, the 80-year-old patient is at higher risk, particularly of a stroke.
Okay. Dr. Schnapp, let me direct a question to you. What is electrophysiology?
Yes, I guess I should feel slighted by Jeff slightly, because he mentioned the various systems of the heart, the muscle, the blood flow, the valves, and he forgot about what makes the heart beat, which is the electrical system. The heart beats because it's electrically stimulated. You have cells in the heart that cause the heart to contract in an orderly fashion. Electrophysiology is the study of disorders of the rhythm, whether it be too slow or too fast. And people can be symptomatic from either problem. People who develop what's called heart block, for instance, don't have any conduction of the electrical impulse from the upper chamber where it starts to the lower chamber, which is actually making the aortic valve open and the blood flow out to the organs. You fix that problem by putting in a pacemaker so that you can re-coordinate the action of the upper and lower chambers. More significantly, frequently, arrhythmias that are too fast. There are a series of fairly benign arrhythmias we call supraventricular tachycardias, which are curable by a catheter procedure that we do that is called ablation, where you can actually affect the short circuit that's causing the rapid rhythm. But then there are other arrhythmias, a cardiac arrest, which can often be the endpoint from people who've had coronary disease or valvular heart disease and have scarring in the heart. Mm-hmm. Cardiac arrest is actually almost a misnomer because it sounds as though the heart is stopping, but in fact what's happening is that the heart is beating extremely rapidly, too much, too fast to actually pump blood anywhere. And the only way to treat that is usually with a defibrillator, a device that will shock the heart back into a normal rhythm, like an ambulance crew does. The problem with an ambulance crew is they're not always there. Your chance of surviving a cardiac arrest if it occurs outside of the hospital is poor, you know, in the range of 5 to 15%, because every minute that goes by that you're not perfusing, your organs are being damaged. A defibrillator, which is an implanted device that monitors your heart rhythm, recognizes the arrhythmia and treats it within seconds, about 10 seconds, and you're back to normal.
You hear often in the news when cases where we have sudden cardiac death. That seems to be often associated with maybe a younger child or maybe an athlete who appears to be in excellent shape in the picture of health. What are we doing, or is there anything that can be done to catch these incidents before they happen?
Yeah, well, fortunately, cardiac arrest in young people is quite uncommon. I mean, the majority of patients who have cardiac arrest do have organic heart disease. There are subsets, for instance, in athletes, of people who have genetic illnesses, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy being the most predominant one, that can be susceptible to these arrhythmias. But that's a small subset. The vast majority of people who have cardiac arrest are people who have organic heart disease. They've had a heart attack before. Mm-hmm. They have cardiomyopathy, whether it be from a virus or from other causes that aren't necessarily defined. And the things that are sort of new in this area from our standpoint are patients who are able to get what's called a subcutaneous ICD. This is a device that is implanted rather than the typical method, which is similar to a pacemaker where wires are placed through a vein up underneath the collarbone down to the heart and the device is planted under the skin. The entire system is just under the skin. Why would you do that? There are major advantages in terms of risks of infection, particularly in patients who have, for instance, dialysis, who have are getting dialyzed and have catheters put in. These systems can get infected. And subcutaneous systems have a far lower chance of that kind of problem occurring.
Okay. We want to encourage our audience that is watching online or listening from a mobile device. It's a great opportunity for you to head to the website and actually get more information, have an opportunity for you to get involved and ask some questions. And hit us up at facebook.com/MedStarHealth or #AskMedStar and @MedStarHealth. So a great opportunity to take advantage of these experts here in our studio tonight. Dr. Courtney, let me ask you a question. You find out that you have a history of heart disease. It runs in your family. That doesn't necessarily have to be a death sentence.
Oh, no,
goodness. Talk to us about that in terms of modifications in your lifestyle.
So, as you've heard from my colleagues here, technology makes this a very good time to be alive, to have heart disease, because the number of different approaches that we have to fixing it is extraordinary. In my career, I've watched this evolve to a point where almost this profession is unrecognizable right now as it was when I started it. But that said, the best approach to this is an ounce of prevention, to be able to understand what it is that you have specifically in your life that may make you prone to developing heart disease. Because for all intents and purposes, much of this disease is extraordinarily preventable. The genetic piece at this moment is not. So if in fact you have a first degree relative specifically, mm-hmm. mother, father, brother, or sister, that may have developed heart disease prematurely in or around 50 years of age, that's really the kind of red light that we'd like to look at to say that the sibling or the child of that person may be at risk. And if that's the case, then it's even more important for that person to do everything possible within their own capability of adjusting or changing those risk factors that they have. Risk factors like high blood pressure, diabetes, certainly stopping cigarette smoking, watching your weight, being active. The most significant issue right now in our society for the development of heart disease is obesity. And a good point of information in the news today, from a childhood perspective, we've made a dent. I mean, so this was data that actually came out today. But knowing your own individual risk factors, creating an approach to them so that you can modify them, make it better, will in fact do the appropriate things to help you be more healthful. Now that said, it's not a guarantee. So if in fact you're doing all the right stuff, you still have to check in periodically and let the doctors do their screening and make sure from a symptom standpoint, as Dr. Ketlagetsu was saying, these symptoms can be completely atypical. So putting them out and putting them in the right perspective to make a diagnosis takes an expertise and somebody who's got an ear to figure out what's going on.
What's challenging about this is some of these symptoms, is some of the things especially that you talked about with women, could be day-to-day things. You think it's stress, you think it's anxiety about work. When do you know it's at a point where you need to go see a doctor?
If your symptoms are concerning to you, if they're not getting better, mm-hmm. if they're provoked by activity, provoked by stress, that's something that you need to have checked out. And again, it's about assessing the total comprehensive risk of a person, the risk factors that we've talked about, their blood pressure, their cholesterol, making sure they're not diabetic or their diabetes is under control, and actually looking and seeing in that context how your symptoms fit in. But if they're concerning, if it's nagging, don't ignore them. Act on them.
Okay. What about an aspirin? You hear about an aspirin a day to help prevent a heart attack. Dr. Bianco?
Oh, absolutely. I think everybody who's 50 years old or older should be taking an aspirin. Aspirin is one of the most fascinating drugs that's ever come into our culture because we find out something new about it every 2 or 3 years. It started as something to reduce fever, and then it became, oh wait, this is a pain medication too. And then we realized that this also has some action against platelets. And not only can it prevent a heart attack, it can reduce a heart attack in people who have already had a heart attack, but it's also been found in some studies to reduce the risk of certain types of cancer. So aspirin is a big deal for heart disease and a big deal for everybody who's 50 or older should be taking at least a baby aspirin. And now we're branching out into these other medications that have similar or more potent antiplatelet effects. And many people that we see will probably benefit from not just an aspirin, but from some of these newer antiplatelet agents as well.
Anyone in the audience have a question? I'm sorry, I'm losing my voice here. I think we have right here.
I suffer really bad with bad nerves and stress, and I get upset real easy. And then I start getting really bad pains in my chest. And sometimes when I get real bad like that, I take my pressure and it like jumps really high up in the 200s. And then sometimes it's okay. But when it jumps up too high like that, it kind of scares me, you know. And I take like my baby aspirin and stuff like that, try to get it down and all that. But I do suffer with high blood pressure, you know. But is there anything that I can do that will help me to, you know, take the pain away? Because sometimes the pain is so severe and it goes up and down my arm and all that kind of stuff. And it kind of really scares me. And, you know, how I deal with the stress to stop it from causing my pressure to go up.
So first and foremost, we have to make sure that your blood pressure in the non-stressful situations is controlled. That's important, right? And then we underestimate how important stress is as well as a risk factor for heart disease. So looking for other ways to control your stress is important, right? And also making sure that your symptoms don't come from heart disease. So if you haven't had a stress test, it may be something you want to discuss with your healthcare provider or your cardiologist if it hasn't been done.
Another question from the audience? You have one? And they're telling me that I need to make the guest stand. So you stand up so we can see you. Okay. I'll come around this way. I feel like Vanna White. Go ahead.
Yes. I've heard that seafood, shellfish is bad for cholesterol. My doctor is telling me. And for 34 years, that's all I've eaten. I don't eat chicken. I don't eat any other kind of meat except for shrimp, crab meat, lobster meat, and things. And I've eaten that. I won't eat land animal. It's a psychological thing in my head why I won't eat it on the farm, seeing them killed, you know. So I don't understand. I've eaten it for 34 years, but I have high cholesterol, but I can get it down sometime. So is there a real risk at the fact that I eat it every day?
So, Dr. Courtney?
The answer to your question is really got two parts to it. The first is, what can we do with diet to actually control cholesterol in our risk factors? And there is certainly some aspect of dietary modification that will address that. But if in fact you do have a problem with your heart and cholesterol with the development of vascular disease, and I think here it's important to remember that we're not just talking about the vascular system of the heart, we're talking about the cerebrovascular system, your kidneys, your legs, et cetera. It's the same problem. You may need to be on a drug that helps control that. Now, we try and ask people to modify their diets to a degree and to be attentive to those foods that may be high in cholesterol. And seafood is, in some respects, high, but it's really not terribly high compared to other foods like whole dairy products and animal fats that are saturated. So, in fact, you probably need to just check your own numbers, know exactly where you are, and if in fact the whole rest of your health issues require you be on a medication to help adjust it, then that's the next step.
I do have a question, but it runs like 150 or something like that. Now, most of the time I run like 149 or 148, and the doctor said I had high cholesterol.
Give you some
food
for thought? It gives you some food for thought to take back to your doctor.
Yeah.
You know, when you hear about open heart surgery, people typically tend to think of a bypass. But Dr. Pierre, could you talk to us a little bit about that? 85,000 valve surgeries done in the U.S., not necessarily a bypass.
We're seeing more and more valvular surgery. Again, as I mentioned earlier, as the population ages, we see more valvular disease, particularly aortic valvular disease. And also with our diagnostic capabilities, we discover more. And so much more of what we do today is valvular surgery. Coronary artery bypass, as time goes on, we see more and more patients that are treated with medication. They're treated by Dr. Wong in the cath lab with stents. And so we see fewer and fewer patients who come for bypass surgery. And I don't have the numbers in front of me, but in the last 3 to 6 months, I bet 50% of the patients we operated on are having some sort of valvular surgery, while a couple of years ago it was less than a third. So we're seeing a definite uptick in valvular cases.
Dr. Wong, when a patient comes to see you, is it typically a diagnosis to determine whether or not they need to take the next step, maybe to serious enough to see Dr. Fiocco for another heart procedure?
Great question. Most of the times when patients come see me, they've already had a stress test and they've had concerning symptoms. Their physician has ordered a stress test, and the stress test has found an area of abnormality that's just concerning for a blocked blood vessel. So I'll perform a diagnostic heart catheterization, usually through the wrist, and to see if there are blockages. If these blockages are amenable to be fixed with a stent, a metal scaffold that we can do at that time, I'll do that. But there are many patients that have such extensive blockages or blockages in areas that would be dangerous for us to put a stent in that I would then refer them to my colleague, Dr. Fiocco, to consider open heart surgery. That's one group of patients. The other group of patients that Dr. Fiocco has mentioned are patients with valvular heart disease. And those patients oftentimes need for us to also measure the pressures in their heart and determine the severity of their heart disease, in addition, their heart valves and their coronary arteries. And depending on that, those patients have many new options now, and perhaps Dr. Fiocco can talk about some of the more non-invasive ways to replace the aortic valve.
Dr. Wang, while we have you, let's talk about the valve surgery. Typically, it goes through the chest, but now there is an alternative. Tell us about that.
That's correct. Traditionally, aortic valves have been replaced with what's called a median sternotomy, which is an incision right down the chest done by our cardiac surgery colleagues. This requires placing patients on a heart-lung machine and stopping the heart. Very effective surgery with very good results. However, there are certainly some patients that are too sick to have this operation. Mm-hmm. And up until 2 years ago, we didn't have good options for those patients. In the cath lab, for decades, we've had the procedure of taking a balloon, a quite large balloon, to actually crack that tight calcified aortic valve. The problem with that procedure is that within a matter of months, the valve shrinks back down, and so it's not a durable procedure. 2 years ago, the FDA has actually approved what's called a percutaneous aortic valve, mm-hmm. and the actual acronym is TAVR, or transcatheter aortic valve replacement. And this is a way for us to actually replace a patient's aortic valve, either from an artery in the leg or from a small incision in the side of their chest, without a major operation. Mm-hmm. This is a new heart valve that's mounted on a stent that is positioned using the calcium that's in there from the patient's old heart valve as an anchor. We expand the new heart valve that's mounted on the stent, deflate the balloon, and then the valve starts working immediately.
Dr. Champ, they come to see you in terms of electrophysiology. Have you already seen one of these other positions at this point, and you're determining, I guess, how to balance that electric activity in the heart?
Well, people come to me from a lot of different ways. I mean, there's plenty of patients who are referred by cardiologists, but also from internists, or patients just recognizing themselves that they have symptoms of generally palpitations. They feel their heart racing.
Okay.
That can be associated with a lot of other symptoms, lightheadedness, dizziness, even passing out, chest pain. Kind of interestingly, I mean, for a long time, when I first started practice, a lot of people had been treated for anxiety disorders. Thought that, you know, they were just anxious, mm-hmm. that the heart was racing, until finally they presented to an emergency room or somewhere and somebody did a recording and found that, in fact, no, their heart rate was 200 beats a minute, and that's why they were symptomatic. So mm-hmm. those are the types of symptoms that you know, bring people to see me. Sometimes it's a question of making the diagnosis. Sometimes I know the diagnosis. Sometimes I have an EKG that recording of the arrhythmia, but frequently it's trying to sort out what could be producing that. We have a lot of techniques to do that. There are monitors, you know, you can wear for 24 hours if the person is fortunate enough to have the symptom that frequently might capture it. But there are other kinds of recorders. There are some that are even implanted. Mm-hmm. There's actually a monitor we use now that you actually just inject under the skin. It lasts for years and is able to telemeter what the heart rhythm is when the patient has the symptoms. They have a box that sits at home and they can transmit this to the cardiologist, so we can find things that are very infrequent, very sporadic. That's the problem with arrhythmias. The problem with arrhythmias is it's like the electrical system in your car. It's never happening when you take it into the dealership. It's just not going to happen.
I think we all know that.
So the arrhythmia is you've got to be there at the moment it happens. And these types of monitors are very helpful in capturing these sometimes rare events.
One of our online guests wants to know, for optimal heart health, how long should women exercise once they reach their target heart rate? Dr. Courtney, this is probably for you.
Well, it's a very difficult question, but typically we'd like to see people do cardiovascular exercise over the course of a week for about 4 to 5 hours. Now that doesn't necessarily mean at all that period of time they are at their target heart rate. And that needs to be something that is determined, I think, with their doctor's direction, particularly related to what their underlying health is. But cardiovascular exercise, as you know, is any exercise where this muscle has to work hard to accomplish whatever your task is. So walking on a treadmill, riding a bicycle, swimming, et cetera, are exercises that work skeletal muscles, your legs, but they require your heart to raise up the heart rate and the workload in order to accomplish the task. I think you have to be somewhat individual on this, depending on what each person's underlying health strengths are, but mm-hmm. 3 to 4 hours per week is probably appropriate.
Is there a danger in not getting treatment for AFib or racing heart?
Yeah, very definitely. AFib is probably the most common, one of the most common arrhythmias that we encounter. Mm-hmm. Atrial fibrillation increases with age. Again, we're seeing more and more of it as it goes on. It's associated with a lot of different heart diseases, but it can occur in people who have no underlying heart problem. In atrial fibrillation, the upper chamber is no longer contracting regularly. In fact, there's no regular activity whatsoever. Because of that, it can predispose people to have stroke. The left atrium, there's a sort of thumb-like projection off of the left atrium in which blood flows into, and in a normal heart, when it's contracting, it kind of goes in and goes out. But when in atrial fibrillation, since the upper chambers aren't contracting at all, blood can sort of sit there, clot, and then break loose, causing a stroke or injury to another organ. So in atrial fibrillation, one of the principal things is to establish what the person's risk for those sorts of things are. Mm-hmm. Usually you have to have atrial fibrillation plus other risk factors, hypertension, diabetes, history of stroke, age over 65 or 75 in particular, congestive heart failure. But anticoagulation is recommended.
Okay. Got a question over here. Thank you for standing.
I'm 86 years old, and my doctor told me about 3 years ago that I had a heart murmur. And he said somewhere down the line, down the road, it might affect me. Well, I've been down the road. And so far, I've done very well, by the grace of God. And so I'm just wondering, what causes the heart murmur? And then my daughter, she has it too. And they're two daughters.
A heart murmur is turbulence. It is blood that is not flowing in a smooth pattern. So you can have a heart murmur if a valve is leaking, because that causes turbulent flow. It's not smooth. You can have a heart murmur if the valve is narrow, because when you narrow it down, it's like putting your thumb over the end of a hose and the water really squirts out fast. Same thing with a narrowing of a valve. That causes a murmur. But you can have just a small amount of calcium on your valve, which probably every 86-year-old person has, and that can create a little bit of turbulence. So a murmur is not a problem necessarily. It really depends on why you have that murmur, and I would think that your doctor would do an echo study to see what the valve looks like, and that it probably looks okay.
One of our chat role viewers wants to know, they're concerned about their mom. She has chest pain that actually has her having difficulty comfortably sitting or sleeping, and she complained of feeling like a balloon was in her belly. But she had an EKG, and that was normal. So is this something that could be heart-related?
Yeah, it's important. I get this question a lot, mm-hmm. Especially after we find that patients have a blockage, and they oftentimes say that they had an electrocardiogram or EKG in the doctor's office, and it didn't show anything. The EKG is a helpful tool that we use, and it's helpful if someone is having the symptoms at the time. And if they're having the symptoms at the time, the EKG is fairly sensitive to find that. Also, if patients have had heart damage, such as old heart attacks or problems with their conduction system, which could signify that they have heart disease, it may be represented on the EKG. But there are many patients that have severe blockages that, if they're not having the pain at the time, will have a seemingly normal EKG. So it's very important to not be completely reassured with a normal EKG, particularly if you're still having persistent symptoms.
And this is not something that's necessarily age-related, correct? In terms of these symptoms, you can have them at any age or a certain age.
We've seen severe coronary disease even as young as patients in their 20s. We typically think of coronary disease affecting patients in their later decades, 40, 50, 60, 70s, and 80s. But I have seen patients even as early in their 20s, which is very rare. But yes, it can start even in that decade.
How important is it to know your family history?
Crucial. It's absolutely critical because, like that component we said that we can't measure, it's signifying a genetic risk. And if you have immediate relatives who have heart disease or coronary disease, you're inheriting a predisposition from those people. So knowing your risk factors from those people is as important as knowing your numbers of your cholesterol, your numbers from your blood pressure, your waist circumference, your weight, your diabetes numbers. It's just as important.
If we could put the graphic up on the screen again so we can get some of our online viewers the information if they want to log in and ask a question to our experts that are here in the studio. Dr. Kortner, tell us again about the importance of diet. A heart-healthy diet doesn't necessarily mean you can't have any of the good stuff.
No, of course not. So there's been so many different swings on diet over the years and really how to approach it. The first thing that I would like to emphasize with diet is that it's about being your ideal body weight, and that you really have to focus on the things that are important in terms of your lifestyle with activity and eating appropriately. And that's calorically looking at what your intake is, not necessarily the breakdown of what those calories are made of. Certainly there is an influence of the diet on your cholesterol. And so if in fact you're more heavy into starches, carbohydrates, into saturated fats, it may adversely affect it. But what we've actually learned over the years is that much of what we our cholesterol numbers are really genetically modified rather than dietary. So first thing, be close to your ideal body weight. Get plenty of exercise. Eat a balanced diet that's appropriate and prudent with the appropriate percentages of proteins, fats, and carbohydrates, and try and reduce the saturated fats. Be high in fiber, and it really is something that has to be unique to each person, depending on what their own individual problems are: diabetics, renal disease, hypertensives, etc. But for the general public, a prudent diet with a 40-30-30 split is probably best.
Probably something that we could all benefit from.
Absolutely.
Dr. Shamp, the treatments that you were talking about, is that something that's for the operating room or is it an outpatient type situation?
You're talking about the catheter ablation type
yes.
thing? Yeah, those are done in a lab similar to it where Dr. Wong works. It's a lab that has x-ray equipment so we can position catheters. Our catheters are generally positioned through the veins in the legs that are brought up to the heart. Generally use more catheters because we have to record from multiple sites within the heart at the same time. The majority of our curative procedures are done using what's called radiofrequency energy, which is just high-frequency electrical current. When we identify where the short circuit is in the heart, we put the catheter at that spot, deliver a little bit of radiofrequency energy, just heats the tissue and creates a small scar at that area that is curative. For the supraventricular tachycardias, which is a large body of arrhythmias that produce arrhythmias frequently in people who are young and healthy, don't have coronary disease, don't have these other things, people as young as teenagers, this is a highly effective procedure. Success rates are well excess of 95%.
Once you have it done, do you have to come back and have it done again?
No. I mean, the chance of recurrence is extremely low, 1 or 2% at the most.
Mm-hmm. Questions from the audience?
Okay. You mentioned the fact that pain in the jaw is one of the symptoms. I'm concerned about it because I have pain in the jaw, and it's mostly when I am at rest. Should I be concerned about that?
Pain in the jaw.
Like I said, any symptoms that are concerning to you are symptoms that you should bring up with your doctor, okay? And the next step may be to do certain tests to see if when we exercise you or we put your heart under stress, if you develop those symptoms or if you develop signs that suggest that there's a blockage in the heart artery.
Talk to me about subcutaneous ICDs. explain that.
So this is a sort of new development. As I said, the typical defibrillator, as I was saying before, is implanted like a pacemaker. So it involves wires put into the body through the vasculature. And these work very well. I mean, these are very good systems. They are very useful. Somebody, in addition to needing treatment for a fast rhythm, a cardiac arrest, also needs pacing, and a lot of people do. There are systems, in fact, that can help with heart failure, biventricular ICDs, which have to be implanted, at least at this point, transvenously. But there are disadvantages to putting things in veins. The veins can close down around the leads and become completely compromise that vessel, so that if something happens, if the wire malfunctions or whatever, you can't get anything else in there, then you've lost this as a site for access. So this newer system is developed to be completely free of the vasculature. It's under the skin. It's, I think there's a video of it, but it's placed sort of on the side with a wire that comes up along the middle of the chest. And it can do most of the things the defibrillator can do. It doesn't pace, but it can treat people who have a cardiac arrest. A large number of devices that are implanted now are put in for people who are at risk. Mm-hmm. So they have reduced heart function, which puts you at risk for a cardiac arrest. They haven't actually necessarily had something happen, but the risk of having a cardiac arrest is directly related to your heart function. As your heart function goes down, this risk goes up. A system like this, particularly if it's in a younger patient, is really an ideal solution, because you're not compromising their vasculature in the future. The lead that is used for the defibrillator system is virtually indestructible. It's very, very durable. It could be the only system they ever need, as opposed to something that has to keep being replaced.
One of our online viewers wants to know, after my release from the hospital following open heart surgery, what concerns might I experience once I come home? Dr. Pugh?
The most common complaint we have from the patient once they've left the hospital is shortness of breath. And shortness of breath is very common for several reasons. One, you've just had an incision on your chest, it hurts, and instead of being up like this, taking deep breaths, people tend to be like this, taking very shallow breaths. So they get short of breath because they're not coughing and deep breathing well. Also, everybody who has any type of open heart surgery develops some retention of fluid in their lungs. And most of the time, it doesn't cause any ill effects, but in anybody that has it to a greater degree, or anybody who is a smoker, they tend to be short of breath. But that's the number one complaint as far as what happens to people once they go home. As far as particular concerns, there really are the only concerns that we have once the patient goes home from the hospital is they have the potential to develop an infection. That is very unusual, but that's what we really stress to the patient. Take your temperature every day for a week. Call us if your wound has changed in the amount of drainage or if there's redness around the wound.
And that's typically something associated with any surgery.
Sure.
Infection. How often do they come back to see you after they have, that major open heart surgery?
It really is once or twice after surgery. Most people within 2 or 3 weeks are driving. They're up and around. If you have a manual labor job, we want you to stay away from that manual labor job for 3 months. But if you have a sedentary job, most people go back to that in 3 or 4 weeks. You are not perfect. You're still a little bit sore. You're still a little bit tired. But I like to tell my patients, there is nothing that I can do for them that is as good for them as getting back to their normal life. That sort of fixes this part of the recovery, the mental part. Men have to drive. They've got to get in that car and drive. It's a must.
That sounds good to me, don't you think, ladies? Guest 547, 66-year-old male, had a Lexi scan 4 with a bad reaction. Have had chest discomfort fairly regularly. Any consequences or concerns from having that Lexi scan?
So the type of drug he's talking about is something we commonly use to test people who can't walk on a treadmill to do the stress test. Mm-hmm. The nice thing about the drugs that we use is that they're very short-acting, meaning these drugs have a short half-life, and within minutes you expect the effects from the drugs to have worn off. So if he's still experiencing symptoms, he should tell his doctor about them, and it may be something else. But it's unlikely to be coming from the drug, and maybe we can think of a different way to stress him since he wasn't able to tolerate the test.
If you have the stress test and everything's normal, does that mean that you don't have any problems in terms as far as heart disease is concerned? Stress test
Negative stress test isn't a green light to go back to the bad ways, right? Okay. It's a sign that you still have to keep working hard at eating healthy, exercising, watching your weight, controlling your diabetes. It's not a license to go back to the old ways, but it can act as a reassurance that things are going well for the time being.
Not necessarily in the clear. Question from the audience? Okay, let me come back here around you. Go ahead, stand up.
Okay, go ahead. If you have a stress test and at that particular time you are really sick or tired, or the doctors feel that you need to come in and get the test to see if you have a blockage, and you're having this pain while you're having the stress test. So you get in the hospital and they give you the test to see if you have a blockage. You don't have a blockage, but you have failed the stress test and you're still having the pain. What should be the problem then?
So there are lots of circumstances where we see people just for the evaluation of chest pain. And that will involve doing some diagnostic testing to sort out whether or not the pain is coming from your heart. There are many things that will cause chest pain that are not cardiac. And oftentimes, it takes going through a test like you did, where you had the stress test, you didn't do well on it, they did a catheterization to look for a blockage, didn't find a blockage, but there is still a pain problem that's going on. And that may take further investigation, either looking at your gastrointestinal system to see if there's a problem with your stomach, an ulcer, gastritis, esophagitis, or something that's really part of your musculoskeletal system that may not be in any way related to any organic problems. But that involves some diagnostic work from your primary care doctor. So we often get involved in doing these studies to sort out where the pain is coming from. But not all chest pain comes from the heart, and that's an important thing to remember. But as Dr. Ketlagetswe said before, and she said it a couple times, if you've got a symptom, as atypical as that might be, and it's causing you concern because it's recurrent, it needs to be evaluated. It does not mean it's your heart, but that's a good place to start.
Dr. Ketlagetswe, tell me, what about hormone replacement therapy? Mm-hmm. Does that impact your heart?
Controversial.
Decreasing your heart risk.
Once upon a time, we thought hormone replacement therapy was good, and we placed everybody on it and thought it would give cardioprotective effects. And it took long-term studies to discover that actually it isn't beneficial and can cause harm. And so there are patients who do require hormone replacement therapy as a result of going through hysterectomies, for example, and suddenly having their hormones taken away from them, and who will need replacement for a certain amount of time. But as something to protect the heart, as something that will help you, we found no benefit. And so our goal is to have people on it for as short a period of time as possible and get them off of that medication.
Okay. Dr. Wong, I thought you wanted to add something.
No, I think that's exactly right. And it's interesting, and this is a nice segue, because it really took a large randomized controlled trial to show that. And many times the intuitive things that we think are going to be beneficial in medicine oftentimes don't pan out. Right. It makes perfect sense that if somebody's hormones are going to go away, that we would replace them and they would feel better. Certainly if it helps with the hot flashes, and we know women develop heart disease 10 years later than men because of their hormones, it makes perfectly intuitive sense to replace their hormones. But it took a large randomized controlled trial to actually figure out that that was not the right thing. And at MedStar Union Memorial Hospital, I think patients don't realize that in addition to all these incredibly exciting technologies that we have here, we also run a very large clinical trial program. And no matter how Star Wars or Star Trek in the future these minimally invasive technologies may appear today, we actually have access to technologies that won't even be available to the general public for 3 to 5 years from now, but we're studying them today. And so I would ask patients to ask their physicians when they're having a procedure if they can participate in these, if it's applicable to them. For example, in the cardiac cath lab, we're actually studying stents that are no longer made of metal. They're actually made of a high-grade plastic that gets completely absorbed by the body, and within 2 years is completely gone. This technology will not be available in the U.S. until 2015, but is already approved and being sold in Europe today. Mm-hmm. In addition, Dr. DJ Shamp is also studying many new defibrillators and pacemakers. There are also new cholesterol-lowering medicines, and we're just about to start a trial looking at an obesity medicine to see if by taking these medications you can also lose weight but lower your cardiac risk of developing heart attacks in the future. So I would ask patients to see if any of these trials might benefit them today.
We have an online guest asking about her 85-year-old grandmother who has an irregular heartbeat. Is there a non-invasive way to treat irregular heartbeat? And apparently she's had open heart surgery in the past.
So, I mean, irregular heartbeat, unfortunately, is not very specific as to the diagnosis. I mean, any disorder of, you know, the regular beating can be described as an irregular heartbeat. So you'd have to know more to say. At 85, I mean, probably one of the main rhythms that you'd be concerned about if somebody has an irregular heartbeat is atrial fibrillation. And there are a lot of things that we can do to get that regularized. In that age group, generally that's going to be medical therapy. In younger patients, certainly people in their 40s, 50s, or younger, we consider catheter procedures, if drugs have failed, to cure atrial fibrillation, a procedure called pulmonary vein isolation. It's a rather involved procedure, but has a really good success rate, actually, for taking care of this. And there's surgical techniques.
That's where we're going next. Right. I'm going to ask you about the mechanical valves and how those different from tissue valves. Which one would you choose if it were for you?
The mechanical valves have really fallen out of favor, not because it's a bad valve, but because it requires you to be on a blood thinner for the rest of your life. And when you're 60 years old, it's usually not a problem to have a mechanical valve and you're on Coumadin, your blood is thinned, you have to have some blood draws here and there, you have to maybe have your finger stuck a few times, but it's tolerable. But it becomes more of a nuisance the older you get, and you're not allowed to stop it because clot will form on the valve. So you get the valve when you're 60, and now you're 75, and you need your hip replaced. Mm-hmm. And so you have to stop the Coumadin and hope that the valve doesn't clot and add other blood thinners to get you through the surgery so you can get back on the Coumadin. It becomes a real nuisance. And so most people are choosing a tissue valve. The problem with the tissue valve when you're 60 years old is that there's a small percentage of those patients that are going to need another operation. Well, if you are going to have a second operation to replace that valve 15 or 20 years down the road, there's a certain risk to that redo operation. And it's a little bit of a higher risk than it was the first time you had surgery. But if you add up the risk of being on a blood thinner for 20 years versus the risk of a second operation, it actually statistically looks about the same. And of course, the risk of the second surgery all occurs in that one little window when you're having that surgery, and the risk of being on the blood thinner is spread out over a long period of time. But most people prefer to have a tissue valve, and I probably 95% of the valves I put in are tissue valves, and most of them will last at least 15 years, and that data is based on valves that were put in 15 years ago. Theoretically, the ones we're putting in today are going to last longer.
Another question from the audience.
What's the difference between a stroke and a heart attack?
They want to see you. I'm the messenger. Don't you come out.
What's the difference between a stroke and a heart attack?
So a heart attack occurs when an area of heart muscle is not getting appropriate oxygen. And that heart muscle, if the oxygen is not restored, will die, and that area of the heart will stop functioning efficiently. A stroke is a brain attack. And what happens in that circumstance is an area of your brain also may be affected by a blood clot that's going to prohibit blood and oxygen from getting to that area of the brain. Now, the difference between a heart attack and a stroke in terms of how you experience it really depends on that area of the brain that's affected, whether it affects your, you know, part of your skeletal system, your left side, or your speech, your swallowing. Both of them can, however, be can cause death. I mean, so, but different organ system, almost the same process.
Thank you very much, doctors. You provided some excellent information. I'd like to have Bradley Chambers, the president of MedStar Health, Union Memorial Hospital, join us.
Thank you, Kelly. Good evening, everyone. My name is Brad Chambers. I'm the president here at MedStar Union Memorial Hospital. And on behalf of the entire MedStar family, I want to thank everyone in our audience tonight for coming out. We greatly appreciate your comments. And I also want to thank everyone online. We do these webcasts as a way of educating our community. We can actually reach a larger audience by doing this, and I really appreciate everyone taking the time and posing those questions to our wonderful panel. And last but not least, a thank you to our panel. We're very proud of the cardiovascular program that we have here at the hospital, and the depth and expertise of our physicians really makes it special. And last but not least, Kelly, thank you, and to everyone at WMAR Channel 2 for supporting us tonight. I hope everyone has a wonderful evening and good night.
And let's give our doctors a big round of applause. Thank you very much for joining us, and I hope you got some valuable information from MedStar Health's 2014 Heart Health Webcast right here. Good evening.